Warning, do not listen to this podcast if hearing about freedom and liberty is not legal for you in your community. And if so, you should immediately move to a hipper community.
Welcome to the Freedom Feens Podcast, a weekly web lab where Michael W. Dean and Nima Vedati cover the punk rockinist, hip-hopinist current events, as well as timeless universal truths about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because there's no such thing as half-free. The Freedom Feens Podcast, available from freedomfeens.com. That's freedomfeens.com.
Freedom Feens!
Freedom Feens, y'all.
Happy birthday, Michael Dean!
Thank you. I'm 47 today, and I still feel young and dumb and full of freedom.
Really? I feel old, and I was 27 a couple months ago.
Why do you feel old today, Nima Vedati?
I don't know. I guess I'm having a third life crisis.
A third of a life crisis. That's
right,
funny.
Right. Well, that's the new thing, you know?
I think people do. There's actually this hippie thing called the Saturn return, which happens, I think, when you're 27. That's like major crossroads in life kind of thing.
I think we had a speech teacher in high school who would always talk about that. She would say, and you're in Saturn now. And you're in Saturn, okay? And shit like that. yeah, I actually watched, I was in her class during 9/11. It was kind of weird. I just now thought of that. Everybody remembers where they were, you know, at 9/11, yada, yada. But I was in her hippie class.
I was asleep.
You were asleep?
Yeah. Okay. I was asleep. Through a lot of it. I mean, I slept until like noon or one that day, California time, which is like 3 New York time. Yeah, I mean, it's many, many hours after it happened. I
think you're like crashed out on the couch or what?
No, I sleep late. I go to bed late and I sleep late. And I woke up and there were 3 phone calls from 3 different friends saying, Michael, turn on the TV. Something horrible's happened. And I turned it on. And I think by then it was like, you know, Bush was standing on a pile of rubble saying, we're going to go to the gates of hell to get these bastards.
I remember I skipped school early to go hang out with some girls, and I got detention later because of it.
Most people remember where, older people remember where they were when Kennedy was killed.
Yeah.
I was in my mama's belly.
Okay. So, see, yeah, you are young. 47, you're still young. You didn't witness the Kennedy assassination.
There you go.
What was your earliest, I guess, world event type memory?
Vietnam War on TV. I was really appalled by it. It was, you know, when I was like 4 years old, it was what was on the news, and it was, they had a nightly scoreboard of like our dead and their dead, like a football game.
Really?
Yeah. And wow. It, I remember we had this foreign exchange student from Belgium, this woman named Magda. She was like 18 and I was like 4. And my sister was in Africa and this woman from Belgium was staying with us. It was through Rotary International. My dad's a member. It was when I was 5. I remember like not wanting to go to kindergarten one day because I was crying and I said, I don't want to go to kindergarten because if I go to kindergarten, I'll have to go to high school. And if I go to high school, I'll have to grow up and I'll have to be a soldier and kill people.
Yeah.
So I was a conscientious objector from as soon as I could talk.
It makes sense, right? When you're a kid, that's what you learn. You learn that killing is wrong, hitting is wrong, stealing is wrong. You learn all those things. And you really believe them. That's before society gets to you. You really believe they're true. And they are, of course. But, you know, when people grow up, oh, it's okay to kill people as long as it's the person we're killing right now. You know, it's the pack mentality.
And I really liked Magda. And she convinced me to go to kindergarten that day by telling me about her brothers who were soldiers and how brave they were and how much her family loved them and how good they looked in their uniforms. But I didn't really buy it, you know.
Right, right.
And when I was 15, I was still a conscientious objector, and I talked to the priest at my school about it. I was going to a private boarding Bible school, which explains a lot. And you know, I told the priest, like, I'm a conscientious objector. I don't believe religiously that I could go fight in a war. And he had me write a letter to that effect, and he kept it on file. So if I got drafted at some point, I could pull that out and prove that it wasn't just something I came up with at the moment to get out.
That's heartening back then. You know, he was on your side. He wasn't trying to convince you to go kill people, which is, you know, what I worry somebody in that kind of position might do these days.
He also took me and 3 other kids from the school to see the band Yes, which was pretty cool.
Yeah, Yes. I can't really recall anything they did. That's before my time.
Yeah, it's classical math rock.
Okay, okay. It's very complex. Have any hits or?
Yeah, roundabout. I'll be the roundabout. The words will take you out and out. We'll spend the day away. Call it morning, driving through the sound of in and out the valley. Yeah, you have no idea what I'm talking about.
No.
Yeah. It's got a really cool classical guitar intro that I learned when I was like 14, and it was like, if you could play that, chicks dug you.
Oh, really?
What do you do musically now as a mating call? You know, instead of playing like progressive rock on an acoustic guitar, what do you do to get laid? Guys rap?
I mean, I don't know. Guys rap, but it seems like still the old cliche stands. If you got a guitar and you're at a college party, you know, chicks are going to be flocking around you if you're decent with it. Same premise, pretty much. But yeah, dudes at, you know, a show or a cypher and they're freestyling, you know, that can be impressive too. So
I always liked in the movie Animal House. You ever seen that?
No, I haven't actually. I should have. That's one of those.
It's a classic movie. Yeah. Even though it's old, you should check it out. But there's a scene in it where there's a guy, you know, some blonde college kid who kind of looks like the Dutch boy paint can guy with that kind of haircut, playing guitar for some doe-eyed girls on the college lawn. And John Belushi walks by and picks up his guitar and smashes it and keeps going.
Yeah, okay, I can see that. I bet, you know, when you DJ, you know, you get a lot of attention from the girls. So there's that, too.
Is DJing really a skill? To me, it's still just you're the kid playing the records at the party like when I was a little kid.
No, that's ridiculous. No, DJing, you mix the music together. So you blend it seamlessly so that 10 tracks sound like they're really one long track. That way people stay on the dance floor and don't leave. Because when the beat changes, if there's like an abrupt change, you know, if they're not beat match, if they're not the same tempo, then people will stop dancing and they'll leave the dance floor.
Yeah, you could do that with your iPod now, though.
No, you can't really. You could do it with two iPods. You could probably do it.
You could do it with an iPad.
You could probably do it with an iPad.
In other words, they have machines for that now.
It still takes some level of human skill, and not everybody uses Serato because what they do is they have virtual programs right now that will mix the MP3s. But you have a controller, you know, like two turntables and a mixer. It's still up to you, and there's still lots of stuff you can do, and it's definitely a skill.
Yeah, so you say. All right, let's move on. Freedom fix.
Okay, freedom fix.
If you want to defend a guy pushing a button on a computer longer, I'll let you go. Go ahead, man.
Because it's not a dude pushing a button on a computer. It's the same thing it was in the past. It's mixing the record. You're letting the record play when it's supposed to play. And not just that, but you can scratch. You can mix things in. You can use effects. It's basically real-time music editing. And that's important. That's what people want to hear. It's definitely a musical skill. There are dudes, we call them press play DJs, who will sit there and press play, but that's not what keeps a party moving, and that's not what people want. Those aren't the dudes who are getting the real money in the game.
Okay, I'm old. Let's move on.
And now, the Nima News with Nima Vidati.
And now, for your daily dose of nanny statism in our daily segment, Tyranny Today.
Tyranny Today.
The Republicans and Democrats are in the process of renewing the Patriot Act with a bunch of creepy additions, which to me, more than almost anything else, proves that they're all the same, man. They're all the same.
They're all the same. They just want control over us. That's it.
Yeah, one of the things they want to do is allow all the gun records to be seized, which basically is national gun registration in a way. See, the thing is, I'll explain this for people that don't own guns. When you buy a gun in a free-ish state, you know, not California, New York. There, it's really hard to buy a gun. It has to be registered. But in Wyoming, Utah, Nevada, you know, a lot of other states, a majority of the states, when you buy a gun in a store, there is a background check to see if you're a felon or a wife beater or anything. And they don't sell it to you if you are. There's a one-page thing you have to fill out, and they run it through a national database and find out that you're okay to own a gun. And then they sell you the gun, and they keep those paper records at the store, and those are only supposed to go to the government if the store goes out of business. And what they want to do now is call in all of those paper records, which basically will be the feds will have a record of everyone who owns a gun, except for there are exceptions. I mean, if you bought it at a gun show unpapered, or if your grandpa gave it to you, if you bought it from a friend, it won't be in that record. And to people that don't own guns, it sounds sensible, like, well, that makes sense. But the thing you have to remember is this doesn't really prevent any crime. when people are found to be a violent felon trying to buy a gun, they don't go after them. They don't arrest them for that, and that is a crime. Basically, it could be the precursor to gun confiscation. I mean, that's what happened in Nazi Germany. That's what happened with Pol Pot. That's what happened in a lot of places, is they just looked at the record of who owned a gun, and they went to their house with men with guns and took those guns. Well, so it's
also
a distinct
Fourth Amendment issue. I mean, they're taking your – you're not being secure in your persons and papers. They're basically doing a search on you by pulling this information, and they don't have – they're doing it across the board to anybody without any due process, without you having committed any kind of crime. They're just taking information so they know your personal information and who has guns and who doesn't.
Yeah.
But Freedom Fix. Freedom Fix. Freedom Fix. We got Rand Paul totally pulling the filibuster on that ass. And he's telling him he's going to sit there and talk, and he wants to keep basically the Patriot Act from renewing, which is part of this bill. So Harry Reid is trying to pull an end run around that and pull that out of that bill and slip it in somewhere else. Because, again, these laws, when they get passed, there's a lot of political juggling, and that's why they stick stuff in big bills, and it's all about making deals and playing the game. So Rand Paul's trying to do the thing, making his Hail Mary pass, his standalone guy kind of pass. And I don't know what'll happen. I don't know where it's at now, but I think the Freedom Fix is that we have somebody on the national stage just basically standing in front of the tank at Tiananmen Square. I don't know if it'll work, but it's very Freedom Fixy that somebody's willing to do that, and we have somebody in the Senate, of all places, who is going to go there.
I mean, the Senate voted for this today. It's passed the Senate, unfortunately. But it passed by less of a majority than this usually passes in the House, which is because there's more Democrats in the Senate, and there are a few Democrats who, you know, get it right.
At least on some things.
Yeah, on some things. But people have been comparing Rand Paul to Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. Do you know that movie?
Yeah, I do know that movie. And that's a fun comparison. He's
young new congressman, shakes things up and filibusters.
Right, kind of making a stand. Well, the Freedom Fix, I think, is still in the stand. And somebody actually went there and tried. And that's the first step. There's more to come.
Well, let's see. This news is from 47 minutes ago. Rand Paul's stand against the Patriot Act. Rand Paul is 435 times more powerful than his father. It's funny.
It is funny. It's also a statewide office, you know. Everybody in the state of Kentucky, a majority of people in the state of Kentucky for that district voted for him.
Yeah. I'd say he's 43.5 times more powerful than his father. They've got their math wrong.
Yeah, yeah. But the sentiment's still there. The principle's there.
Yeah.
Although, you know, I think from an educational point of view, I think Ron Paul still is the man. I mean, he's making his new run at presidency, and no matter what happens electorally, I think the fact that people are listening to him, he wrote the best campaign book ever. You know, it's not really even a campaign book, it's a philosophy book. And I think what he's doing for the movement, definitely in my mind, is what's powerful to me. I think he's changing people's hearts and minds and winning the intellectual battle. That title has to still go with Ron Paul.
Okay, where it is now is they employed a procedural maneuver to end the debate. The Senate voted 79-18 to end cloture, which allows the Senate to move forward with an up and down vote. But Paul says he may still win a deal that would permit votes on some of his amendments. And one of his amendments is to not do this thing.
Okay. Well, how sad is it, no matter what the principled person believes, because of the way the system works, the people who want to screw everybody get to win. No matter what, they're going to get it through somehow, some way.
I got another freedom fix.
Okay, let's keep it positive.
If we're done with that one?
Yeah.
Well, it starts with a tyranny today and then goes to a freedom fix. The United States Department of Agriculture fined a Missouri family $90,000 for selling a few rabbits without a license.
$90,000?
Yep.
Wow.
And also, like, said, this cage, this huge cage, is 1 inch too small. You know, it was kind of like the movie Brazil. They were just getting them on tiny little infractions just basically to mess with them.
Right. That kind of thing disgusts me. So what's the – is there a fixed part? You got to give me the fixed part.
Missouri lawmakers, Democrat Senate Claire McCaskill and Republican Representative Billy Long have contacted the family, saying they'll help intervene with the USDA, and a Tea Party group is planning a protest at a USDA office in Ozark, Missouri on Wednesday.
Good. It's good to see that. See, it's good to see people recognizing the wrongness of the crats, the bureaucrats, ruining people's livelihoods and doing something as horrible as indebting them to the tune of $90,000. Taking that much of their property and money just because a cage was an inch too small or they didn't have the proper permission slip.
Maybe that'll be what the next Civil War is about, is the rabbits.
The rabbits.
See, though, the thing is that things like that only happen when it's not about light bulbs, it's not about rabbits, it's not even going to be about guns, because those don't affect everybody.
Right,
you know, the Civil War was about something that affected everybody on each side. They all had a strong opinion. And the Revolutionary War was about something that affected everybody.
Once they get so many silly regulations, once they start going after everybody, and people, I can actually wake up and make that connection that, hey, this person getting screwed because of the rabbits, they're getting screwed just like me because of something else or because of business taxes or something like that. Once we all realize it's the same evil and start targeting.
Well, people need to be educated with that, because otherwise they won't. You know, there's a thing in Boston Tea Party's gun Bible about banning, and one of the things that stood out to me was that they can ban anything. It's sort of a Six Sigma thing, that they can ban anything that doesn't affect the majority of the curve, the middle of the, you know, a lot of the people.
Right.
Like, they could ban mountain climbing, and there'd hardly be a tick. They could ban competitive bike racing, and there'd hardly be a tick.
Okay.
And I've heard him say that there's a lot of gun owners who aren't very strong about the Second Amendment. Like, he conjectured that if they outlawed guns, some of the people who do bench mount, minute of angle shooting, who aren't really gun people, they're more math people, he said he thinks those guys would quietly move over to radio-controlled helicopters without a fuss.
Right. Well, what do you think about a large portion of mall ninjas? They might start buying air rifles like the dudes in England or the neutered guns.
Yeah.
So it's divide and conquer, basically. It's we'll screw different segments of people, so much so that they're all being screwed, but they don't see it that way.
I say thank God for the scary f***ing gun nuts, because, you know, a lot of people think, oh, those are the people that are going to get everything banned. But I think, in a way, those are the people that keep everything from getting banned, because those are the people that sound like they might do something.
Well, and they're people that are principled. It's good to see that there are people that'll stick to their guns, so to speak.
Basically, literally, and die for it.
Yeah, well, it's good to know that there are people who still draw a line in the sand and say, oh, something, I'm not going to stop doing something just because 51% of the population told me not to. As long as I'm not infringing on somebody else's right, that majority can't tell me what to do. It's minority rights, and the most important minority is the individual.
Ayn Rand said that.
Word.
Oh, one thing I wanted to mention, it's completely unrelated to anything, but did you know that Glock pistols have a little compartment in the grip, inside the grip?
A little compartment? Okay, you mean between, like, the magazine and where the grip extends the furthest? That little gap?
Between the magazine and the palm of your hand?
Yeah.
Yeah. You could probably put 3 or 4 joints in there, and you can buy a little plug to plug them.
Oh, really?
Though I think since most cops own Glocks, if they found your Glock and it was plugged, they'd be onto it.
Yeah, and they'd probably be pretty pissed.
Yep. Guns and weed.
Guns and weed, baby.
But we don't do that. But I'm just saying, you know, I'm wondering if gangbangers, you know, not gangbangers, but people who enjoy the guns and the weed, if they do that.
I don't know. I'll not comment on that. But you could put anything in there, right? You could put some cash. You could put
a copy of the Constitution.
You could put your legal drugs. You know, it's the war on some drugs. You could put some of the drugs that aren't
your
we're not
cold
at
medicine.
War with. Yeah, the East Asia drugs, not the Eurasia drugs. You know, we're at war with Eurasia, not East Asia.
What's East Asia? China makes our cold medicine.
It's a 1984 reference. You know, the three countries, the three super nations, they're always at war with each other. But word. So Glock talk, huh?
Glock talk.
Glock talk, baby.
You know, more thing I want to say about Ron Paul, Ron Paul.
Okay, go for it.
I feel like America is a burning building right now, and those two are the only people saying, this way to the exits, come with us. And the rest, the Democrats and the Republicans, are saying, wait, we're putting up a shiny new coat of paint in here. And I told my friend that Warren Cruz that, and he said, yes, and look at these new flammable curtains we're hanging. Aren't they lovely?
But of course, yeah, it's so true. They're the only ones saying, hey, You can't keep doing anything the way we're doing it. The whole thing is going down. Speaking of that, I think it was Stefan Molyneux who also had an astute thing about the politics of it all and, you know, hoping that there could be some political change. And that's basically, the country is that Titanic and Ron Paul is, you know, trying to be the captain when it's about, you know, a 45-degree angle breaking in half about to sink under. So that's an important thing to remember too, I think, is, you know, whoever is the next president is going to get stuck getting blamed for all the horrible stuff that's to come. The debasement of the currency, the depression, you know, whatever we have.
What are your plans for the apocalypse? And did you say Titanic?
Titanic. Titanic.
It's Titanic. You said Titanic.
Oh, okay. That's okay. Yeah. Here, I'm going to say Titanic and you just edit it back in.
Okay.
On the Titanic.
Sure, I'll edit that back in.
All right.
And what are your plans for the apocalypse?
I don't have good enough plans, man. I mean, we got some food stockpiled and we got some guns and ammo, but I mean, who knows how the world, what happens? I mean, it's not like there's, you know, zombie apocalypse scenario one and zombie apocalypse scenario two, and you can just pick which one you're going to plan for. I don't think anybody knows how it's really going to play out or if it'll happen, you know, that kind of thing. You just got to, I guess just have resources and know what you're going to, I guess not know what you're going to do, but have as many skills as you can because it could go any number of ways.
You know, weren't we talking last time about the EPA when we were talking about steel bullets and trying to outlaw lead bullets?
Yeah.
Maybe the EPA will require gold bullets. It'll be that Chris Rock thing if each bullet costs $5,000.
It could, huh?
Yep.
Yeah. Horrible idea from Chris Rock, by the way.
I know. I always hated that. I thought it was funny back in the day.
Yeah, I did too. I guess the biggest logical flaw is only rich people would have guns then. If you're
No, poor people would steal them from rich people.
Poor people would steal them from rich people? Okay. Yeah.
At gunpoint. They'd save up and buy one bullet and then use it to go around and steal more.
Yeah, yeah. A ton of horrible unintended consequences for anything like that. All the status laws are silly Chris Rock ideas, and they all have consequences like that.
And, you know, you don't really need a gun to commit a violent crime. People do it all the time with knives. You can do it with a fucking brick.
Yeah, you can do it with your hands. People,
that was the thing in San Francisco, I remember, was it was fairly common for drug addicts who were dope sick and needed dope to go up to a street drug dealer and just hit him over the head with a brick. It's like, they were so down and out, they couldn't even get a kitchen knife, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Brick will do the trick. I mean, any number of things you can find in the environment. If you're going to swoop down on somebody and sucker punch them, I mean, you don't need a gun to do that.
A brick will do the trick isn't as sexy as more fun with a gun. It doesn't sound like a bumper sticker. More fun with a gun does and is. A brick will do the trick, doesn't. You know, I've heard this thing. I've heard it from military people and from anti-war people. It's a good saying. We don't know exactly how World War III will be fought, but we know World War IV will be fought with rocks and sticks.
That is a good saying. There won't be anything else.
Yep. You'll get bigger boards with bigger nails.
We could always go back to blunderbusses. I mean, you could always find powder to blow up, right? Especially in a post-apocalyptic world.
You can make powder.
Yeah, exactly.
There's actually a Star Trek I really liked where Captain Kirk defeats some kind of monster by improvising a shotgun. He takes charcoal from a fire, he scrapes sulfur off some rocks that are sticking out on the desert, and finds saltpeter somehow and mixes it together and then uses raw diamonds as the shot.
Nice.
And then sticks it in like a big bamboo tube.
Okay. So supposedly in that Star Trek future, nobody edited out the history of guns from all the textbooks.
Although he's a scientist, he'd figure it out. Gunpowder was invented simultaneously different places. It's something that people would just come up with, I think. Even if you got rid of all record of it. And there are so many bullets out there that they'd find one and you could reverse engineer it.
Right, right.
Even if you took them all away.
Right.
So talk about your experience with Johnny Law and guns this week.
Johnny Law and guns.
And you don't need to say what town it was in, but yeah. I like the comments you had.
Okay. So me and the wife actually decided to go get our concealed pistol licenses. That's what they're called where I'm at. Basically because she works as an admission assistant at a college, you know, like one of those schools where they teach HVAC and medical assisting, that kind of thing. And she noticed a lot of the applicants, you know, they have to say when they're a felon. She
said, one of those places where, like, gangbangers, brothers and sisters go to learn trades.
Right. Wonderful place. But a lot of the forms, you know, it'll ask you if you're a felon or if you have any crimes and you have to report them. And she said an alarming amount of them were possession of a gun. And she was just thinking, huh, how odd that all these people are felons just for possessing a gun, and now they can't vote, and they have to end up coming here, and they don't have any prospects because they're felons, and their futures is screwed. I mean, you know, you can still live life and be successful, but it's really hard being a felon. So she was basically like, let's go get our concealed pistol licenses. And she wanted to get a gun, too, because she's been in the park recently. And one of the things we've noticed where we're at, which is Washington State, is people just aren't friendly here like they are in Texas. You know, in Texas, one of the things you do
when
Wyoming, of course. Well, when you see people in the street, right, you give them a nod and you smile or you say hi, some kind of gesture to say, hey, I'm friendly, you know, friendly forces. I'm not an enemy kind of thing. Here in Washington, there's none of that. Menacing dudes were walking by her and she sort of smiles and says hi and they just sort of mean mug her, give her a dirty look.
Mad dogger.
You know, I guess that's the word out in Cali. Maybe it's a West Coast thing because
it is.
I haven't seen it. You know, where I'm from.
Stink eye. Give her stink eye. That's stink the East Coast eye. Thing.
Yeah, mean mug, I guess. We call that in Texas. But, you know, that's reserved for dudes the beef. You know, you can give them a mean mug, but not just strangers. You know, you don't just mean mug everybody.
In New York City, there's jokes about this in sitcoms, but, like, there is some basis to it. Like, people get stabbed for looking people in the eye in New York City.
Ugh, yeah. So, in any case, since she was alone, she decided, you know, maybe she should carry a gun sometimes. You know, I'd taken her out shooting, taught her how to shoot. She's actually a great shot. So she wants to get a pistol, and we both want to get concealed pistol licenses. And so we go. And first of all, we're in the city hall, and she notices something. And so she picks it up and hands it to me. And it's a license for having a yard sale. This is our first impression of our city hall. Apparently, there's a form. It says you have to pay $5, fill out an application 90 days in advance before you have a yard sale. You can't sell anything that you've had for less than 6 months.
Is that an anti-thieving thing?
It might be an anti-thieving thing or just an anti-commerce thing. Like,
I know they have that here.
With pawn shops, I think they have a 30-day waiting period in Wyoming, which was a big stink because a lot of them were selling gold, too, and jewelry, and the gold prices change all the time, so they're upset because they couldn't keep up with the market. Either way, it's anti-commerce, but I think this has, you know, some overtly anti-commerce-ness to it because they don't want people, instead of, you know, buying some type of permit to have a store or brick-and-mortar thing, people just selling stuff at yard sales all the time as a business and making money. But how ridiculous that is my first impression, that realizing that the place I live is so statist that you can't even do something as voluntary and simple and been done for hundreds of years, forever, as a yard sale without getting the government permission and having the goons come to you if you screw it up. I haven't seen that yet. I don't know. Maybe I'll look into it. So anyway, we go upstairs to get our concealed pistol license. And of course, one of the things that I realize about it is it costs, you know, $55 a person. So we're out $110. All it is us giving them our money. It's just us giving them our money for a permission slip. There was no test.
There's no test.
No test.
I have a problem with that because I have a problem with gun licensing in general, but there's three things that licensing entailed. One is them stealing money. One is them having a list of names. And this is for anything, for cars, for yard sales, for weed, for guns, anything where there's a government permission slip.
There's control. That's the other thing. They decide who gets to have a gun and who doesn't.
Okay, it's four things. It's control. It's money. It's a list. And those are all bad things. And there's one good thing. One thing you could argue is good is safety education. To get a car license, you have to prove that you can drive a car in a relatively safe manner. In Wyoming and most other states, to get a concealed carry permit, you have to take a class in gun safety and gun use. They don't have that in Washington, which is why Wyoming doesn't recognize Washington's permits.
No.
Washington recognizes Wyoming's permits. There's a map that I'll post on the site. I'll post a link to it of the reciprocity of concealed carry permits, CCWs, whatever you want to call them. And the map, you can click on one state and see by color whether they honor that state's permit or not. And there's a weird thing about the map. You have to refresh the page to check another state's permit, like if you want to, you know, see which one goes where.
It's actually really useful. And I think you bring up a good point about, I don't know if I'd call it a good thing, but it's a thing that I think would exist if there were no government. In a state of anarchy, you would have people that would test people. You could get a seal of approval or I'm good at holding a gun kind of thing.
In LibPair, I think it would be more like shame. And I don't know if shame's the right word, but it's like, okay, for instance, I'm not a very good swimmer. I can swim. I could keep from drowning if I were thrown in the water, but I'm a really bad swimmer. When I go to a public pool and there's a bunch of kids there, And I jump in and start swimming. Kids laugh at me, literally. They're like, "Mister, you don't know how to swim? I'm 12 and I know how to swim." And I think it'd be the same way with guns. Like, if you're at the range and you saw somebody doing something unsafe, you'd be like, "You don't know how to use a gun?" I mean, it would just be ridiculously societally, not shame, but just like, really? You would just go, okay, everyone else has it. It'd be almost peer pressure. And I think that everybody who owns and especially carries a gun should take a class in it and learn to use it. And I don't think it necessarily has to be, in my view, not in the government's view, but in my view, it doesn't have to be a certified instructor. It has to be a qualified instructor.
Exactly.
And we said that in the beginning of our movie. We said, if you do decide to shoot guns, be sure to receive training from a qualified instructor. And I specifically didn't write that as from a certified instructor.
Right, right. But I think it's an important distinction to make that, you know, when you're an anarchist, I'm not advocating that people don't learn things about guns before they use them from a qualified instructor. I'm just saying the government shouldn't have a monopoly on who gets what as far as instructors and as far as licenses.
Yeah. I actually took my CCW class from a very qualified and also certified instructor, Mama Liberty, who's in our movie, the woman who says, "Hi, I'm Susan. I'm a 63-year-old grandmother, and I don't smoke pot, but think it should be legal."
Right.
And says some of the coolest things in the movie, too.
And she's an anarchist, and she was also a qualified firearms instructor. And did she do well? I'm pretty sure she did.
She did great. She taught me a lot.
Exactly. And to me, it was just really upsetting that I had to go and pay money. It reminds me so much of high school when if you were like late 5 minutes, you couldn't go to class unless you went and got a tardy slip. It was all just about control. So you have to come here. When you're older, you have to pay the tribute. You have to pay the tax.
The tribute to Caesar.
To Caesar, which is pretty much what it is. I have to go pay them for them to give me a right that I already have, for them to allow it.
I think it's cool that your wife is getting one too, because she, like my wife, was originally afraid of guns.
She was, yeah.
We got guns 3 years ago after someone tried to break in our house. The next day I said, "Honey, we're getting a shotgun." And my wife said, "But that's admitting that the world's a bad place." And I said, "Well, sometimes the world is a bad place." And being the only Democrat in California with balls, I got a gun even though she didn't want one.
Is that the gun that I have now?
No, it was a shotgun. It was our first gun.
It was a
gun.
Shotgun. Okay.
And then we went out and shot it, and she was, at the end of the day, she was like, "I really like this. I want to get more guns."
That's true. And maybe shooting can do it. I mean, my wife never even thought, I mean, she might have paid lip service to, "Yeah, we'll address that at some future point, you know, in our conversation." But she would have never admitted to, you know, ever wanting to have a gun someday until she went, until about the second time we went out shooting. And she was a good shot. The first time she pulled the trigger, and I guess I didn't let her know how much power would be coming and how she sort of needed to brace herself so the gun wouldn't kick back. It didn't hit her in the head, but it nearly did. And so that kind of scared her for a bit. But the second time
You don't have 22s. I usually start people with a 22.
Right, right. Which I don't have a 22. I have a Mosin and a 9mm handgun. So.
You have a gun with a lot of kick and a gun with so much kick that the kick can kill animals around you. You don't even have to shoot them.
Right, the shock wave will keep mosquitoes away.
Yes. Did you make that up? That's funny.
Yeah. So, but yeah, she was a great shot. She was, we were actually, sometimes I don't have targets, so I just shoot stuff that I have, and I had her shoot the lid of a can of Spammo and try to get the different letters, so she did pretty good at it. But yeah, so basically, all getting a license here in Washington entails is going, paying the money, and then fingerprinting. Oh, and you have to tell them, you have to describe every mark on your body was one of the questions.
They don't have that here.
Describe any tattoo, birthmark, or otherwise identifying feature that you have on your body.
And you put, "Well, I've got some Persian writing on my arm."
Well, I actually wrote out my name in Farsi, which is what I have tattooed on my left arm, and I just wrote it out and put it in quotes and said, "Tattooed on my upper left arm."
In New York City, they just would have taken you away right there.
Well, I'm hoping it doesn't get me in trouble. Actually, when I was in the back getting fingerprinted, one of the police employees that I talk to on a, not a daily basis, but occasionally as a news reporter, I say, "Hey, what's up, man?" He's like, "Oh, what are you doing here?" I said, "Getting my concealed pistol license." And the lady who was doing the fingerprinting was jokingly said, "Oh, are you going to give it to him?" And the police employee said, "I don't know. With that beard, he kind of looks like Al-Qaeda."
That's
I was
funny.
Just like, wow. Yeah, but actually I was like, well, he must really trust me if he's willing to go there. And
yeah. So. Yeah, my wife got her permit, and she works for a lawyer who like knows every judge and every cop in town. And she got her permit, and then her boss has never mentioned to her, "I know you carry a gun." But like the next day and from then on, he started making jokes like, well, if we're ever attacked, DJ can protect us. You know, it's like, it's supposed to be confidential, but apparently it's not. I mean, he immediately knew that she'd applied for a concealed carry permit.
Right.
And there's nothing wrong with that. You know, I don't like the idea of it, but in this situation, it wasn't a bad thing.
Right. But, I mean, that brings up a good point, and my wife was wondering that. She was like, so, does this mean I can just take my gun anywhere? You know, we haven't gotten the gun yet, but we're planning to. And so I was sort of explaining, you know, some government buildings you can't, at least in Washington. I know things are a bit different in Wyoming, but they do have gun check counters here at, like, the courthouse and stuff. So you walk in by the metal detector, there's a gun check. So I guess you'd have to go check it. But she was like, well, what about at work? And I was like, well, I guess it depends on whoever owns that private property, which is how it is.
In Wyoming, well, they have gun check lockers in the courthouse, but it's for cops. And I didn't know that it was just for cops. And I went in there one time with my wife. She had to do something in her work. She did not have a gun with her. And she went in, and I went in behind her, and they didn't really know I was with her. And I said, I need to check my gun. And like four guys were like, you can't bring a gun in here. And I just, and then like some other people came up to get checked through, and I just kind of slipped out before they chased me.
Really? Wow. I mean, I'm glad you got away, but you know, if you were in a place like Chicago or something and tried to slip out, you'd have the SWAT team on you.
Yeah, they would have shot me.
Well, you heard about that case in England where the little boy kicked a ball. It broke a window in a greenhouse, and the police scrambled a helicopter to find him.
You know, in England, I heard about a case where a guy found an old rusty shotgun in his garden that someone had thrown over his fence, like probably years previously.
Okay.
You know, like probably someone fleeing the police had just tossed it over a garden fence.
Right.
The guy found it in his garden, and being a good, conscientious citizen, he did the right thing and alerted the constables. Ugh. I found a gun in my garden, and they arrested him and put him in prison.
Yeah, I can totally imagine that.
It's like, what's the proper thing to do in that situation? If I found something illegal in my yard, like drugs or something that someone left there, I would just throw them down a sewer or throw them away. I wouldn't call the cops.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that goes back to our normal principle of don't ever call the cops.
So I'm looking at my Wyoming permit, and on the back of it, it says, permittees are prohibited from carrying a concealed weapon into any facility used primarily for law enforcement operations without the consent of the chief administrator, detention facility, prison or jail, courtroom, meeting of a government entity, meeting of legislature or committee thereof. And actually, I have a friend who's a state rep who's gotten in trouble for bringing his gun into the state's,
oh, really?
State Congress. Yeah.
Wow.
Not trouble. They were just like, you can't do this. You know who I'm talking about.
Yeah,
I totally do.
I'm just surprised.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
Any school, college.
Can they have bodyguards that bring them in?
Probably. Because they'd have permission from the...
Right.
From the,
they'd have the proper credentials, the proper licenses.
You cannot bring it into any school, college, or professional athletic event not related to firearms.
Huh.
Now, that's funny. If there was a rifle competition at the high school, could you bring your pistol in your pocket? I don't know. Portion of an establishment licensed to dispense alcoholic liquor or malt beverages for consumption of the premises, which is devoted primarily to that purpose. You cannot conceal carry in a bar here, but you can open carry in a bar here with permission of the owner.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, a lot of this doesn't apply to open carry, but the government stuff probably does. Although, actually, I think it's in Newcastle or Gillette, people have been open carrying guns to city meetings, and they're trying to ban that.
Huh, I didn't know that. Things are happening in Wyoming, huh?
Cannot bring it into any place where persons are assembled for public worship. Now, Mama Liberty has permission from her church to bring her gun to open carry.
Okay. And in a place like Wyoming, the cops aren't going to go try to knock her, at least not where she's at.
Well, it's legal because she has permission from...
Right.
She's not concealed carrying, and she has permission from her pastor.
Right.
And she's kind of the guard for the church.
Nice.
Let's see, 9, elementary school or secondary school facility, 10, college or university without written consent of the security service of the college in writing, or place where carrying of firearms are prohibited by federal law or state regulation. Like, interesting thing, you can now carry in national parks. So you could carry in Yellowstone, but you cannot carry in any of the buildings in Yellowstone. Like, if you go into the bathroom, you're breaking federal law.
I did notice that when I went to Yellowstone last summer. All the buildings have a big sign with a gun and the banning sign, the international banning sign around them.
Yes, the red line in the circle.
Yeah, which is really interesting. You'd think that the people who run the shops would want to encourage everybody to come in and buy their goods, but...
You know, the thing with concealed carry and all these restrictions of states and places, it kind of makes sense to someone who doesn't own guns, maybe. But think about it if your driver's license was like that. If your state driver's license wasn't honored in all states and wasn't honored in certain places in your state.
Right, right. If they did that with anything else that you have on you on a normal basis, like if cell phones were like that, for instance, you can't bring your cell phone into certain places and you have this long list of prohibitions that you might not remember at all times. And of course, with a gun, if you go somewhere where you're technically prohibited from it, on a technicality, you know, it's your normal daily routine. You're not a violent person. You end up in the wrong place with a gun and bad things can happen to you. The government can do bad, bad things to you.
You become a criminal.
You become a criminal. That's how ridiculous it is people just in the normal course of their days not hurting anybody else for having an inanimate hunk of metal on their hip or in between their waistband can become felons.
I kind of think of nanny statism as the new white man's burden. Do you know what the white man's burden is? Well, let me explain it, because not everyone probably knows. White man's burden was a racist kind of political theology of England and a lot of other countries, but primarily the British Empire, that it was the burden of the white man to go to these places where primitive man lived without running water and conquer him, kill a bunch of them, take over, and teach him to live like a non-savage.
Right. Civilize them.
It's an incredibly racist thing, and it's what drove a lot of totalitarian expansion and empirism throughout history.
Of course, then it just became, let's steal from these people. And then instead of white man's burden, it became spreading democracy, which is where we're at now.
Which is the new white man's burden. And now it's been turned inward on the citizens of this country.
Right.
And it's kind of it's not the white man's burden, it's the educated ivory tower, Yale and Harvard man's burden to civilize us savages in Wyoming and make us get rid of our guns and make everybody everywhere use the right kind of light bulbs and make everybody get rid of their rabbit farm and make sure they're licensed to have their yard sale.
Right, right. I think the desires are always been there. I mean, you had alcohol prohibition. You had people looking down on, I mean, just in our movie, the racism inherent in prohibiting the things that the lower classes do so that they can't have any fun. I think now what makes the big difference is we've enabled them so much. The government has grown so tremendously that you can have things like cops busting up little girls for selling lemonade.
Or jailing a man for growing marijuana for his cancer-stricken wife. I'm going to link that one. That one's just horrible.
Yeah, let's go ahead and talk about that a little bit. Should we do a tyranny today?
What's there to say? I wanted to talk a little more about the white man's burden, though. I wanted to talk about this book that I highly recommend for anybody. It's called The Redneck Manifesto by Jim Goad. The full title of it is The Redneck Manifesto, How Hillbillies, Hicks, and White Trash Became America's Scapegoats. First of all, this book is one of the funniest books I've ever read, and it's one of the most politically incorrect books I've ever read. The basic premise of it is that reverse racism or anti-racism attempts have gone so far in this country that basically the only people you can be racist about and get away with it is rural white people. I mean, if you think about any joke you hear on TV about a redneck that comes from a non-redneck, I'm not talking about Jeff Foxworthy or anyone. I'm talking about like people looking down on rednecks. And not just jokes, but news items, anything. And if you substituted, if you took the sentence that person's saying and substituted the word redneck and replaced it with blacks, Jews, Arabs, gays, women, any other minority group, you'd get kicked off the air.
I would have an objection, of course, when it comes to Arabs or anybody of Middle Eastern descent or Muslims in this country. I think, especially in some circles, you know, you can get a pass. I mean, you have people on air and certain right-wing type groups neocon, fine, not right wing, where you can go so far as to say that Muslim people don't have a soul. I think in wartime, in today's climate, you can get away with that, and Muslims and Arabs are sort of the new gooks. They're the new Japs without souls.
I've heard black comedians joking about that they're happy with that, because it's like, wow, we're not the niggers anymore. Somebody else is.
Yeah, well, I think Carlos Mencia did that tired bit, too. But yeah, I mean, I do think that is valid, though, that white, there has become this white guilt thing, too, to where basically, in my mind, favoring any class, treating any class differently, whether it be bad or good, is where the problem is. It's having, again, going back to divide and conquer, and the government sort of tries to separate us into these groups, where it's which group do you favor? I think that's another problem with class warfare and being a Democrat as well, is people think that we should eat the rich now. Like, it's this division of classes against each other, and each side just wants to get a hold of that apparatus of the state and screw the other side and give themselves the benefits. That's the problem, is we need to just get rid of the system that allows us to divide each other and screw each other over, where we're exploiting each other, and that's what the big game is who's going to exploit who.
And I think a lot of that has to do with gun ownership, not let's go shoot people, more like I think they want to get rid of the guns. The state wants to get rid of private ownership of guns because then they can do whatever they want.
Well, I think they want to get rid of private ownership of everything. They want to own everything.
Yeah.
And they do. I mean, you
well, what's the thing about cars? They want to put a black box in cars now.
Right. And I don't know how far along this is, and this has been
hinted at before. It's
just
an idea now, but they all start with ideas.
They all start with ideas. But I think something happened recently, like they're taking some federal bureaucratic organization is taking a new look at it. And basically it would be, yeah, you would have a little black box in your car. I don't know how that would work technologically.
And it's supposed to be for crash prevention or learning from crashes. But you know, it would definitely have GPS information in it too, so you wouldn't be able to go anywhere without them knowing.
Well, and if it has GPS information, you know, it can basically tell how fast you're going, so they would know if you're speeding. I mean,
you could just get a ticket in the mail without even being seen by a camera or a cop.
Right, right. And of course, you know, there are instances where it's completely legitimate. That's why the idea of a speed limit that you can't go over, a hard and fast line, is kind of silly to me. Is, you know, there are some instances where somebody's coming at you or you might have to accelerate to get around something dangerous. And in a case like this where you would just automatically get ticketed, of course they're not saying that yet, but that's the slippery slope, is one day you could have a situation where they're looking at your moves, and if you do something illegal that the computer says, it just flags it and you get a ticket. How ridiculous is that?
You know, back to the white man's burden. You know what's interesting about rewriting history is everybody considers Republicans racist because they don't want to give lots of money to the poor. But people forget, and they do not teach this in school anymore, the KKK were Democrats. Most of the people in the South trying to secede from the country because they wanted to keep slaves were Democrats, and a Republican freed the slaves. I'm not saying I love everything about Lincoln, but let's put that in a historic perspective. Democrats were racist and Republicans freed the slaves.
Right, right. Although, to me, the freeing of slaves wasn't really any platform thing on Lincoln's part. I don't think he gets credit for it. I think it was just a war move. He hated black
some speech. Yeah, he didn't like black people. He thought they should never be able to vote, etc. Let's talk about some useful information here. Since we've both had experience with wives who didn't like guns and now want to carry them, what advice do we have for people with girlfriends or wives, or women with boyfriends, or women with girlfriends, or men with boyfriends? You know, if you're into guns and you have a significant other who's afraid of guns, what can you do to get them to like guns, and at what point do you dump them if they're a lost cause?
I think for me, one of the things I've experienced is don't push somebody with anything. Don't sort of push your beliefs, but explain. If they're going to ask questions, especially if they're a significant other, oh, why do you carry a gun, or why do you need to do that? Explain and be principled about it. Be principled.
Because I love you, baby, and I want to protect us.
Right, right. And that's the thing, too. And situations will arise that if they know and trust you as a person and know you're not going to hurt them, and also know you have the gun and feel like you're their protector, they're going to become curious. And so I think always being principled, not getting crazy and saying things like, oh, I want to go out and shoot so-and-so, which hopefully you're not that kind of person anyway.
I know.
But just being principled and rational, I think they'll naturally think, oh, well, I trust this person, and they're obviously very smart, and they're obviously very safe, and they have this tool that we can use, you know? Then you become, hopefully you replace the idea of the government or the state or the cops protecting them in their mind, and then they realize, hey, I can do this too.
I think a lot of it is just getting used to them. And like I said, I would recommend starting with something really small caliber, like a 22, and working up. Because otherwise, if the first time someone fires a gun, it kicks really hard, that's going to be etched in their head and they're going to be afraid of guns. And actually, there's a thing with accuracy of anticipating the bang where people kind of pull the gun while they pull the trigger.
Right.
Because they're afraid of the bang.
If you
start them out with a 22, that's not going to be as big of a problem. Another thing I'd recommend is time and education and reading as much as you can from people who use guns. When I first got guns, I was terrified of them. I owned them, but I thought they were like snakes that could jump up and bite me. You know, like I didn't carry a bullet in the chamber. I first got a shotgun, then we got 22 rifles, which we never kept the 22s loaded, but we kept the shotgun loaded in the house, but never kept one in the chamber. I still don't keep one in the chamber with it because I like the idea of being able to rack it as a warning to somebody.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of a universal sound that's etched into everyone's DNA from movies of like, you're about to die when you hear
right.
this ka-chunk.
Because every time you move a gun in a movie, it has to make that sound. So if they don't hear that sound, they don't get scared.
Yep. But, you know, now when I first got handguns, I wouldn't keep them in my room loaded because I was afraid I was going to sleepwalk and sleep shoot, even though I've never sleepwalked in my life. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
And now I keep a loaded 40 caliber Glock with a 5-pound trigger pull with a bullet in the chamber, no safety, on my bedstand above my head, about 5 inches from my head when I sleep, and it's not an issue.
Right, right. I think as far as educational materials, one of the things that really did it for me and gave me sort of a passion to learn more was Boston Tea Party's Gun Bible.
Yep.
And you lent that to me, and that made me passionate about learning more, and it taught me so much. So I think that did a big thing in my life as far as education.
So we were talking about different places you can and cannot have a gun. One thing they do in Texas that's kind of interesting, and then we'll segue into Texas, and then we'll talk about TV shows we love, and then we'll end. Texas, if you have a concealed carry permit, you can carry into any business unless there's a sign on the door that says you can't have guns here.
Right.
The sign has to be a certain size, a certain font, and a certain wording to be legal.
Okay.
And what a lot of places do is they'll put a sign that's not legal, that they just make themselves, that doesn't fit that criteria. And it's kind of a nod-nod-wink arrangement to where the people that are regulars there know they can still carry their gun, but the tourists aren't scared that there are guns there.
Okay, that's pretty smart, actually. That's gaming the system in a freedom way, I guess.
Yep. So, Texas. In Texas schools, a picture is worth 1,000 calories. Did you read about this?
No, go ahead and spill the beans.
Well, Texas schools are spending a whole bunch of money to create this computer system that photographs what's on a kid's tray when he takes it away, and then when he brings it back to see what they're eating and what they're not eating. And they're spending tons of taxpayer money to do this. Yep.
Wow. They are literally going to monitor what food goes into your kid's body with pictures.
Yep.
Wow. And so what happens then? If you don't eat the right amount of mashed potatoes or other carbs, you're going to get punished? You're going to get a letter grade doctor from lunch or what?
Probably eventually. For now, I think it's just to tweak what they serve the kids.
Hmm. Interesting.
Texas tried to ban smoking, and New York City banned smoking this week. Can you imagine New York City banning smoking?
Wait, did they do like the whole out, like you can't smoke anywhere in New York now?
Any public park, there's a whole bunch of places.
Wow.
But yeah, pretty much public parks, beaches.
The only place you can smoke is like inside your house or something?
Yeah. And you know, there's one town in California where that's illegal under certain conditions, Calabasas. Two towns over from Agoura Hills where we used to live. Like you would not be able to smoke in your building. It's if you live in an apartment building that shares vents with other apartments or shares a wall with a common area, like the laundry room, you cannot smoke in your house.
Wow.
And you cannot smoke on the street in that town.
Behavior modification. I mean, Hitler did it first. He was the one who had such a big...
He was anti-smoking.
Yeah, he had an anti-smoking campaign. He saw it as a sign of weakness, and you shouldn't be destroying those lungs because those lungs belong to the state.
I know. And a lot of people would look at that as ridiculous, like saying, well, anti-smoking is Nazi because Hitler did it. But it is, and it's not just because Hitler did it.
It's because it's the principle of the state deciding what you do with your body, which you own.
Yeah.
It's the state saying, no, you don't own your body. We do. We get to decide what you do with it.
Last time I was in Ireland, they had just banned smoking in bars there. If you can picture that. Like, the drinkinest, smokinest country in the world, they'd banned smoking in bars. It was sad.
Very, very sad. Of course, when they banned smoking in bars in Austin, the way everybody gets around it is they would just put up balconies or expand onto the roof. And, you know, they would put a bar up on the roof, and you'd go up to the roof and smoke there because it was outdoors.
I went to an AA meeting while I was in Dublin. It was in the basement of a Catholic church, and everybody was chain smoking. In California, you can't smoke in most AA meetings, and actually, Hubert Selby started that, or helped start that many years ago, right, which is kind of funny. But he, you know, he had medical issues. He was missing more than one lung. So maybe I'll give him a pass with that. And I think it was like he got his meeting that he went to every week because they liked him. He got them to not smoke there, right, but it just spread because it's California.
Right. Well, that's, you know, like, that's a voluntary thing. If he's asking everybody, right, please don't smoke, that's cool.
Yeah, he was not a nanny guy at all.
Yeah.
But it spread to the nannies. And it's like you cannot smoke in – there's a couple meetings you can, but most meetings in California you cannot smoke. And – I went to this meeting in Dublin, and it was like I couldn't see people 4 feet away from me. There was so much smoke in the air and so much guilt in the air. It was great. It was like Irish Catholic guilt minus the alcohol. Most AA meetings in America are kind of like people are kind of happy, and it's kind of like a party atmosphere. Like, hey, we're sober. I've got my 5-year chip. Yay. Way to go, Bob. And in this meeting, it was like, and I've got my 5-year chip. And they're like, oh, yay, Seamus. Yay. It was just, it was sad and depressing and guilt filled. And everyone's share was about, well, I've got 13 brothers and sisters and they all still drink. And they think that I'm sick because I don't drink. And yeah.
Yeah. It does not sound like a fun place to be, Michael.
Yeah. But so Texas tried to outlaw smoking.
F that. I'm assuming it didn't work. I don't think something like that could work in Texas. I hope not.
Talk about Texas's drinking while brown laws.
Okay. So basically, we came across this Mother Jones article, which they're really bad on a lot of things, but they seem to be good on this nanny state issue. Apparently, they're saying that Texas has one of the most lax public intox standards for arrests. To where basically cops will just go to bars, inside bars, and they can arrest people for being intoxicated in public because they were in a bar drinking. And unfortunately, it's come about that a lot of them will just pick based on their personal discretion. So say they don't like Mexicans or they don't like those gangbangers. They can go and just pull them out of a bar, throw them in the paddy wagon. And that is Texas.
Now, why do they call them paddy wagons? Do you know?
Is that an Irish thing?
Because all the cops in New York originally were, right, Irish. It's racist, but I'm part Irish. I'll let you say that.
Yeah. I thought it was really interesting to note that this is basically a lot of it is based on Mothers Against Drunk Driving lobbied really hard for this kind of thing. And so it just reeks of nannyism and this sort of the nannyism state complex, I guess we could call it.
My friend Peggy used to have a drinking club called Damn. It was Drunks Against Mad Mothers.
That's great. Where do I sign up?
I think you just did.
Awesome.
Although she's been sober for many years, but she's probably still into that. That's good.
All right. Well, you ready to wrap it up, B?
I want to say that SWAT raids are the new perp walk.
How so?
Because they do the perp walk, you know, handcuff you and photograph you walking into the police station in front of the cameras to humiliate you and to help sway the jury in their favor. I think they use SWAT raids now when they don't need to for the same reason.
Right. Then they can show the pictures and they say, this guy was so bad we had to use the SWAT team,
yep,
kind of thing.
I saw another interesting thing that said tasers are the modern day whip. Did you see that?
I did see that, and I thought that was pretty profound. And it makes sense.
It's
pain compliance. It's if you don't,
yep,
you don't go the way we're prodding you, we're going to electrocute you.
Yeah, it's like police used to only have one weapon and it was lethal. And it's they had to choose when to use it. And now that they have non-lethal weapons, they can just use them whenever they want.
Right.
To keep us compliant on the plantation that is America.
I think it's also important to note that tasers are not non-lethal. They're less lethal. Several people die regularly from complications after tasering.
If you're not healthy or if you're on drugs or if you're old or if you have a heart condition.
Right. Not only that, but you just fall flat. I mean, if you get tased and you fall and hit your head
tased.
In the wrong way. You do.
You've been tased.
I've been tased, yes.
I will link the video of Nima volunteering to get tased by cops for a news piece. Now, did they dial down the electricity or was that a full dose?
No, that's a full dose. That's what they were using there. It's basically 5 seconds. I know a lot of the civilian models actually go for like 30 seconds.
Now, describe that experience to us.
Getting tased? Basically, like the first 2.5 seconds of it, I had no idea what was going on. Like, it was like when you, it was like I was on some kind of psychoactive drug and I just went, whoa, like the world ceased to exist in the way I knew it. And then.
Was there a blue flash in your mind?
No, it was just like, wow. And then when I realized that insanity was intense pain, then I was like, oh, I need it to end as soon as possible. So I think I yelled out like, stop, stop. I don't remember. But you lose all control.
It's pretty sexy. I don't know. You're pretty bold.
The thing is, that if that happened to you and you were running away, you just plop and you could hit your head into a fire hydrant or something and crack it, crack your skull.
Yeah.
So it's less lethal. I think it's a misnomer to call tasers a non-lethal weapon.
So I think we're actually out of time, and I want to save our discussion of wonderful libertarian TV for next week.
All right. Ron Swanson's the man, suffice it to say.
Yeah. I'm going to put a tiny, short little song of mine here called Single Crackling Blue Flash that I just thought of. And I'll put the lyrics up because we like to put music in.
Yeah.
And it's basically my imagination of what it would be like being swatted. You know, it's a guy running through his house with the SWAT team after him, maybe shooting back, maybe not. And it's called Single Crackling Blue Flash. And that's what he sees when the bullet enters his brain and he dies.
Yeah, it's powerful stuff.
It's yeah, thank you. It's kind of inspired by the Mr. Swan's death scene in Moulin Labe.
Right, right. And also kind of mirrors a recent incident where the guy in Arizona was gunned down, 71 shots from a SWAT team, and he had his AR-15 out. He was getting ready for the home invaders.
Yep.
Just riddled with bullets.
Yep. So it's been good, and I would encourage people to go on iTunes and review and rate this podcast and to go and comment on the site, freedomfiends.com, and downloads are up. We got 2-3 gigabyte days this week and then several that were well over 1 gigabyte. So we're getting some people listening and we appreciate it.
Thanks, y'all.
And I'm
definitely appreciate it.
And I'm 47 and it's my birthday and there's nothing I'd rather be doing than talking liberty with my friend Nima Vidotti.
Hell yeah. Happy birthday, man.
Word.
Peace.
Worms. All right.
All right. Good deal.
Feens podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around. Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Every Friday night, we'll have an exciting new episode where Michael W. Dean and Nima Vidotti weave their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it.
available from freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com. Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them.